الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters, the topic of today's lecture is talk to Allah. And in my view, the finest example of talking to Allah, and I will give you many such inshallah, but in my view, the finest example of talking to Allah, meaning saying something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then responded to, is in the Asbab al-Nuzul of the last ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah, where when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَإِنْ تُبْدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ تُخْفُوهُ يُحَاسِبُكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ فَيَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed and said that whatever is there in the heavens and the earth belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that what is in your hearts and your actions, what you speak and what is hidden, are both known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes, He will punish for those thoughts and for those actions, and if He wishes, He will forgive. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reports that when this ayat was revealed, this was so heavy on the Sahaba that they went to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said that they fell down on their knees. They didn't make sajda to him, they just fell down on their knees before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said to him, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to pray and we pray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to pray and we pray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to pay zakat and we pay zakat. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayat is saying, وَإِن تُبْدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ تُخْفُهُ يُحَاسِبْكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Whatever is inside you, meaning your thoughts and your desires and wishes and whatever is happening in your heart, and what is visible, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold you to account for it. يُحَاسِبْكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. Allah will take us up. فَيَغْفِرُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُعَذِّبُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. If He wishes, He will forgive, and if He wishes, He will punish. So the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to pray, we pray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to give zakat, we give zakat. But now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that He will take account for our thoughts and for our desires and what is in our hearts. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we have control over our tongues and we have control over our actions, and we try to do that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we try not to do that which does not please Allah. But we have no control over our thoughts and we have no control over our desires. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes us for them, then we will be destroyed. I'm talking about talking to Allah, saying something and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responding. So before I tell you what the reaction of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, tell me this statement of the Sahaba, this maruda, this request. This is not a complaint, but definitely it's a request. Does it sound reasonable to you or no? Yeah? But you know what the reaction of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was? The reaction of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reports that the blessed face of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam became red with anger. And he said to the Sahaba, are you going to be like those who came before you? And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ahkam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's orders were revealed to them, they said, Sami'na wa asayna. We heard, but we are not going to do it. We heard, but we will not obey. Are you going to be like that? We hear, but we do not obey. And then Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered them and commanded them, and he said, قُلْ سَمَعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا غُفْرَانَكَ رَبَّنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ. Say, O our Rabb, we have heard and we will obey. Forgive us, Ghufranaka Rabbana, forgive us, O our Rabb. Wa ilayka al-masir, and to you is our return. Now this is where the whole issue of talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes. It begins with complete and total obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. As I mentioned many times before, it is not unthinking obedience. It is not blind obedience. It is obedience because we understand who Allah is. It's unquestioning obedience. It is not blind obedience. It's unquestioning because we have gone beyond the point of questioning. There is no doubt in our mind about who Allah is. We do not need convincing about who Allah is. We do not need convincing about our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do not need convincing about what we owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of all His ni'mat and all His blessings that He has given us. We look in the mirror every morning and we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of the picture we see in the mirror. We do our work and we succeed and we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we succeeded. We make a lot of effort about something and we do not succeed and we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we did not succeed, knowing that the reason He did not give us was not because He could not give us, but because He did not give us. It's not that He was, you know, He didn't have it, but He deliberately chose not to give us. And in that not giving us, there is khair for us, there is blessing for us, there is goodness for us. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Qul, sami'na wa ata'na, ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir." Say, don't say like the others. Don't say we hear, we don't obey. Say we hear and we obey. And forgive us our Rabb. Forgive us, O our Rabb. And to you is our return. And the Sahaba said, "Sami'na wa ata'na, ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir." The Sahaba did not say, "Oh no, Ya Rasulullah, you know, we really didn't mean that. You didn't understand us. We were not complaining. We were not rebelling." Nothing. There were people who were on the truth. There were people who were sincere. They knew why they came. There was a thought in their mind. They were concerned. They were worried. But when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told them to do something, they did it. And that is the reason why the root of all connection with Allah, talking to Allah, is an outcome of connecting to Allah. You can't talk to somebody without a connection. So talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that connection begins with the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us how to win His love for us. One is to love Allah and say, "I love Allah." And the other one is to say, "Does Allah love me?" And what did Allah say about that? The ayat of Surah Al Imran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Qul in kuntum tuhibbuna Allah fattabi'uni yuhibbukum Allah wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum wallahu ghafurur rahim." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Say to them, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say to those who claim to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say to those who claim to love Allah, make my ittiba. Emulate me, imitate me, do what I do, say what I say. Then what will happen? Yuhibbukum Allah. Then Allah will love you. Allah will love you. Why will Allah love you? Because you are emulating Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Obey the Nabi, then Allah will love you. And when Allah loves you, what happens? Yaghfir lakum dhunubakum wallahu ghafur rahim. Allah will forgive your sins and Allah is ghafur rahim. So now the Sahaba understood this lesson very well. The Sahaba did not need convincing about following the Sunnah. The Sahaba were on the Sunnah. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Say, Qul sami'na wa ata'na ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir," that was the end of whatever doubt they had in their mind. So no arguments. They said, "Sami'na wa ata'na, ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir." Now see the wages of obedience. See the result of obedience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salam. with the last two ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah. What do we know about the fazilat and the value and the honor of these ayats? Among many other things, Rasulullah ﷺ said, the one who recites these two ayats in the morning, when he wakes up, these will be sufficient for him for the whole day. And when he recites these two ayats in the night, before he goes to sleep, they will protect him and be sufficient for him or her throughout the night. So the Sahaba, what did they say? Samana wa atana ghufrana karabbana wa ilayka al-masir. Whose words were these? The words of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salam. We're talking about talking to Allah and Allah replying. Allah sent Jibreel alayhi salam, and Jibreel alayhi salam came and said what? He said, Amana Rasulu bima unzila ilayhi min rabbihi wal mu'minun. كلنا من بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. See the honor that Allah gave them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said this in his own words, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the words of his Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He took the words of his Nabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which the Sahaba repeated, and returned them as his kalam, to be recited in Salah till the Day of Judgment. As his kalam with the fazilat of his kalam. Whose words? The words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whose words? The words of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah knows what's in the hearts. Allah knows why the Sahaba came to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciated their obedience to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Instant obedience, without argument. But Allah knows what's in their hearts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved that anxiety. La yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa wusaha, laha ma kasabat wa alayha maktasabat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't worry. You will not be held responsible for what you say and you think. For what you think and you feel. You will be held responsible only for those things which you do and say. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took away that anxiety from them. And then the shan of my Rabb Jalla Jalalu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught them how to make dua. This is Allah replying. Allah taught them how to make dua. What is a better method of making dua than the method that is taught by the one to whom the dua is being made? What is more acceptable as a dua than the dua that is taught by the one who accepts this dua?
رَبَّنَا لَا تُوَاقِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا وَأَخْطَأْنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ وَعَفُ عَنَّا وَاغْفِرْ لَنَا وَارْحَمْنَا أَنْتَ مَوْلَانَا فَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ.
آمين يا رب. This is the, in my view, one of the finest and the most beautiful examples of talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, I remind myself and you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to talk to Him. Allah said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we have not created the jinn and the ins, the humans and the jinns, for anything other than our worship. We did not create them for anything other than to talk to us. We did not create them for anything other than to recognize us and glorify us and sing our praises. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately took care of the anxiety. If I am going to be spending all my time worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then how do I eat? If I spend all my time worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then who looks after my family? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I don't ask you for rizq. We don't ask you to feed us. We don't ask you to feed our own other creatures. We don't even ask you to feed yourself. Inna Allah huwa ar-Razzaq dhul quwwati al-Mateen. Allah is the Razzaq. Allah is the Razzaq, and Allah gives and He feeds and He gives rizq, and it's not only food. It's all that a person requires in this life is rizq. Everything a thing. Your knowledge is rizq, your health is rizq, your spouses are rizq, your children are rizq, your food is rizq, your money is rizq, your honor and position in society is rizq. The amount of ibadah you do is rizq. Yeah, think about this. Those who are in itikaf, Allah gave you special rizq. Special rizq. Ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is rizq. Min Allah ta'ala. If Allah had not given you the special rizq of taking you out of your dunya and putting you inside His masjid and giving you complete peace of mind, no worry about anything, only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His house. If Allah had not given this, what would you do? I'm not saying you would do anything haram. You would not be doing haram. You would be doing halal. But you will be busy like anybody else. You are going to work and coming back and this and that and travel and transport and traffic and whatnot. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala freed you from all that. Freed you from all that. Come and worship me as much as you want. Make dua. How much? As much as you want. Make zikr. How much? As much as you want. Allah gave us rizq, and Allah opened the doors and said, take whatever you like. Imagine you're standing in front of the treasure house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is to give something, no matter how generously, and say, here is this portion. Here is this truckload. Here is this container load. Right? Here is this whole ship load. But there's a quantity. And another is to open the door of the treasure. He said, take what you want. Take what you want. Huh? Abdul Rahim Khan Khana, he was the regent of Akbar. When Akbar was put on the throne, he was about 10 years old or less. And Abdul Rahim was the prime minister, and his title was Khan Khana, the Khan of the Khans. And he was a very wise man, very big scholar. Of Islam as well as a scholar of Persian and Arabic, and a very wise man, and also known to be extremely generous. He was a very big-hearted man. So Abdul Rahim Khan Khana was effectively the emperor, was the Mughal emperor, because he was ruling in the name of Akbar, who was the actual, but Akbar was a little kid. So Abdul Rahim Khan Khana, I'm talking about taking from the treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abdul Rahim Khan Khana was traveling from Delhi to Aurangabad. Now, we're not talking about Emirates first class. You're talking about the whole of Emirates as the country, not Emirates first class. So this was the king traveling. So you have a whole army with him. You have a whole advance party which goes to the place they are going to camp, and then the entire camp is set up, and all the tents and the food and the pomp and splendor of the Mughal Empire, and the darbar tents and so on and so forth. So when Abdul Rahim Khan Khan reached the first manzil, the first stage, and in the evening he came and sat in his darbar, and he's sitting on the throne, and people are gathered. A fakir came and recited one sher in Persian. He recited one couplet in Farsi. And the couplet he recited was, Munim bako ho dashto biyama gharib nist. Munim bako ho dashto biyama gharib nist. Har ja ke raft khima zadu bargah sakht. He said, the munim, the wealthy person, the great person, whether he is on a hill on a mountain, or whether he is in a absolutely biyaban, which is desolate land in the forest, he does not become poor. Gharib nist, he doesn't become poor. Har ja ke raft, wherever he goes, wherever he reaches, khima zadu, his tents are set up, bargah sakht, and his darbar is there. So whether it's on the top of a mountain, whether it's in the middle of a forest, whether it's in the middle of a desert, makes no difference to him. The wealthy man remains wealthy, he does not become poor. This was his, he's saying this in praise of the king, of the regent. So Abdul Rahim Khan Khan called his treasurer and said, give him 100 ashrafis, give him 100 gold coins. Right? So the man got his gold coins, he went to it. Now, second day they reached the stage, the next stage, and then again the same story in the evening. Soon as Abdul Rahman Khan came and sat on the throne, this fakir came again and he said, Munimba koho dashto biyaban gharib neest harja ke raft siqima zadu bargah sakht. And Abdul Rahman Khan said, give him another one. So he gave him another bag of Ashrafis. He got another 100 gold coins. Now the third stage they went to, third place they came to, and they camped. And the darbar was set up. No sign of this man. So Abdul Rahman Khan Khan waited for a while, then he asked somebody, he said, where is that man? He was coming every day, last 2 days. Go look for him. So they went and hunted high and low, they couldn't find him. So they came and said, Sarkar wo to nahi hai, he's gone. We don't know where he is. So Abdul Rahman Khan Khan says, kam zarf nikla, lena nahi aaya. Humne to pehle din se 8 manzil ka irada kar liya tha. He said the man has no, there's no substance to him. Kam zarf nikla. He couldn't take. He said, I had decided on the 8 days of this travel. I had decided for 8 days. He could only take 2. And who is this? This is a minuscule slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla Jalaluhu. What about my Rabb Jalla Jalaluhu? Away. Are Allah se lena sikho yaar. What can you take from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The treasures of my Rabb Jalla Jalaluhu have no ending. There's a beautiful hadith Qudsi, which I want to read the translation of that for you. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya Bani Adam, O children of Adam alayhi salam, O son of Adam, do not be afraid of any power or sovereignty. Don't be afraid of any power or any king. Do not be afraid of any power or sovereignty as long as my sovereignty remains and my sovereignty never ends. Ajib, I think this thing when you read the hadith and we read the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, apart from the meaning, just think about the majesty of the address. The command of the address. The magnificence of the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks. I remember I was in New York and we were in Jamaat and there was one white American revert guy who was there. And he was blonde and he had a blonde beard and he had blonde long locks, long hair. So we used to call him Jesus Christ because he looked like the pictures of Jesus. So I asked him, and now he is from Maine. Now Maine is in Northeast America and it's the boondocks. I mean, it's like in the middle of nowhere. You've got some beautiful, phenomenal forests, but that's about it. I mean, you have to go hunting for human beings. This guy was in Maine. So he was studying in a seminary. He was studying to be a priest. And he said, my assignment, we asked him, how did you come to Islam? So he's explaining this. He said, I live in Maine. And he said, I came to Islam because I was given the Quran, the English translation. And I was told, find fault in this thing. Because this is your job, find fault in this thing. And he tried to find fault and he became Muslim. So he says, suddenly one day, he in the middle of the night, literally he said it was maybe 12 o'clock or something, I got this thing that I have to accept Islam. But where does he go? There's no Muslim in Maine. There's no Masjid in Maine. So he said, I got in my car and I started driving. And eventually in the morning I reached Boston. And in Boston I went hunting around to see, early morning in Boston, where is he going to find a Masjid? But anyway, he hunted around, he found a Masjid and he went and accepted Islam. He drove all night to go to Boston to find a Masjid to accept Islam. So I asked him, I said, what is it, what was it in the Quran that struck you? And the amazing thing he said to me, I remember Allah. He said to me, it was the majesty of the address. He's not talking about meaning. See, the meaning is fine. He said, the way Allah said these things, the majesty of the address. He said, when I read that, I said to myself, this can only be God. Yeah? Can't be. No human being can write this. This has to be God. This is no, but this is true. This has to be God. The majesty of the address. And so also in this ahadith of Qudsiyah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks. So Allah is saying in this, O son of Adam, do not be afraid of any power or sovereignty as long as my sovereignty remains and my sovereignty never ends. O son of Adam, do not fear titan sustenance. Do not fear poverty. We are earning and eating haram because we are afraid of dying of hunger. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The only species which fears hunger is the human race. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O son of Adam, do not fear tightened sustenance so long as my treasure houses are full. And my treasure houses never empty. Are shant hai wo bayan ki, kaise Allah bolta hai? Do not fear poverty as long as my treasure houses are full and my treasure houses are never empty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O son of Adam, I created you to worship me, so don't play. And I guaranteed you your sustenance, so don't make yourself exhausted. Allah is not talking about tiring your limbs and doing hard work. Allah is talking about worry. Allah is saying, don't get afraid and don't get worried. Where will my food come from? What will happen? No. So this is my responsibility. Inna Allaha huwa razzaqu dhul quwwati al-matin. The ayat of Surah Al-Zariyah, which I recited before. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I swear by my glory and might. If you are content with what I have allocated for you, I swear by my glory and might. Bi'izzati wa jalal. If you are content with what I have allocated for you, I will bring comfort to your heart and your body, and you will be praised by me. Waladhikrullahi akbar. And you will be praised by me. And then Allah says, I swear by my glory. On the other hand, if you are not content with what I have allocated for you, I swear by my glory and might, I will set the world loose on you, where you will run like animals run in the wild, and you will still not get more than what I originally allocated to you. See the majesty, see the command. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, do what you want. In the end, what I want will happen. You want and I want. If you are content with what I want, then I will make you happy with what I have given you. It will suffice for you. I will protect you from poverty. But if you are not content with what I want, then I will set you loose and I will set the world loose on you. And you will run behind your sustenance like a wild animal runs in the forest. And at the end of that, you will still get what I want. You won't get one grain more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O son of Adam, I created the seven heavens and the earth effortlessly. So would it trouble me to simply send a loaf of bread to you? What is this? And then he says, O son of Adam, don't ask me for tomorrow's sustenance. Don't ask me for tomorrow's risk, just like I have not asked you for tomorrow's deeds. Don't ask me for tomorrow's sustenance, just like I have not asked you for tomorrow's deeds. And then the last one. O son of Adam, I love you. So my right over you is that you love me. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran so beautifully, كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. Allah said, how can you deny Allah? كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ. How can you deny Allah? كُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا. You were dead. You didn't exist. There was no mention of you anywhere. And I gave you life. And life is not just life. Life is not just breathing. Allah gave us life. Allah gave us everything that we have. Then Allah says that one day you will die. I will take that life back. And then I will resurrect you. I will raise you again. And to me is your return. So do whatever you want. Play whatever you want. But remember that the return is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My brothers and sisters, spiritual problems need spiritual solutions. Just like material problems need material solutions. If you are hungry, and I show you beautiful 3D images of phenomenally brilliant dishes, big 65-inch television set, 3D images of beautiful food, you are very hungry, and I'm showing you these things. And also I have an aromatizer, and as you see the food, you're also smelling the aroma of this food. Will it take away your hunger or will it increase your hunger? It just make you more miserable. It will just make you more miserable. And I'm telling you, why are you hungry? Why are you miserable? I just showed you this beautiful, you know, 7-layer. I just showed you this fantastic 7-layer, you know, ice cream sundae. So why are you hungry? What will cure your hunger is a dry piece of bread with water. What will not cure your hunger is this phenomenal 3D display of this food. So why do you think that the spiritual hunger that every human being has, why do you think that this can be cured by material things, by shopping, by watching movies, by doing all kinds of things, so-called entertainment? And I'm not even talking about haram. Because people do that also. But even the halal part of it. Why do you think that your internal spiritual hunger can be cured by any of that? So how do you talk to Allah? By awakening your spiritual self. By feeding your ruh. By feeding your soul. We are disconnected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because our souls have become... they are not dead yet. We are almost dead. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu is standing in the battle of Yarmouk. And the entire might of the Roman Empire, the Eastern Roman Empire, is arrayed before him. They say there was an army of about 200,000 soldiers, 100,000 Romans and 100,000 Christian Arabs. And somebody who was standing with Khalid Walid, he said, what do you see? I mean, are you not afraid? And this is the entire might of the Roman Empire. Imagine, I mean, the glitter on weapons and the gold and the brocades and the silks and the armor and whatnot, right? Khalid Walid radiallahu anhu laughed and he said, I'm not afraid of dead things. He said, dead things? What are you talking about? These are soldiers, this is the army, they're alive. He said, they're not alive, they're dead. He said, how? He said, because Rasulullah said, the one in whose heart there is no zikr of Allah is dead. He said, there is no zikr of Allah in them. So if you go to a Qabristan, which is a huge Qabristan, in that Qabristan there are 100,000 graves, are you afraid? No, they are graves, dead things. What is there to be afraid of? So Khalid Marid says that these are dead things. I ask you and me, I ask you and remind myself, Do we have the zikr of Allah in our hearts? We are so used to living like dead things that we have forgotten what it means to be alive. You have no idea what does it mean to be alive. We have forgotten. Because we're used to living like corpses, animated corpses, zombies. You don't feel pain, you don't feel pleasure. Because pain and pleasure comes what? Comes how? Not this physical pain and pleasure. Pain is to be away from Allah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say to Bilal radiallahu anhu, call the adhan. That is my quratul ayn. Let me go back to Allah. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, about him, somebody asked his servant, describe for us the day of Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said, he waits from one salah for the next salah. And in that period, he recites Quran. So he's doing work. He's a businessman. So he would be doing his work and so on and so forth. But continuously connected with Allah. And waiting for the time of salah. As I mentioned to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala connected his Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam to him in Isra and Miraj. Yesterday we spoke about that. So how do you talk to Allah? By being connected to Allah. And how will you be connected to Allah? By constantly being in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This consists of reciting Quran, it consists of sending durood and salam on Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it consists of any other kalimat of zikr, as the case might be, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu akbar, la ilaha illallah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, whatever it is. And it consists of being concerned about the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, over and above the pleasure of anybody else. So obedience and continuous zikr with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what connects the abd to the Rabb. This is what connects Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innul qulub." So peace of mind, the cure of depression is in the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innul qulub. Peace of mind and tranquility of the heart. The cure for depression is not Prozac. The cure for depression is not antidepressant drugs. The cure for depression is the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jalla jalaluhu. Because the soul is not satisfied until it is connected, until it gets its food. The soul of the food is the zikr of Allah. The food of the malaika is the tilawat of the Quran. So please feed your souls, not only your bodies. We literally dig our graves with our teeth. We eat ourselves to death. Just feeding the body all the time, continuously, whether it's food or whether it's other things and our vanity and our, you know, desires of all kinds, haram and halal. But what about the heart? What about the soul? A state of starvation. So very important for us to feed the soul. Now therefore, what about those who did that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in Surah Al-Baqarah. This beautiful ayat of describing his conversation with Ibrahim alayhi salam, Khalilullah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this ayat, وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّي أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Now just put yourself in that situation. Stand somewhere and watch this conversation happening. Allah is describing the whole conversation. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّي. And Ibrahim said, remember, Ibrahim said, Rabbi, my Rabb. كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Show me how you give life to the dead. This conversation. He's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, you bring the dead back alive. Now show me how you do it. And see Allah's response. Wallahi. Qala, Allah said, I said, Awalam tu'min. Allah said, why you don't believe? Like, how beautiful is this? Just reflect, and this is why I say, when you read Quran, reflect on the Quran. Make tadabbur on the Quran. Don't just read the ayah. Think about this. Put yourself in that situation. This is a conversation between the Abd and the Rabb. What does it tell you about the closeness that there is between Allah and Ibrahim alayhi salam? Khalilullah. No barriers. No formality. No formality. He's talking to his Rabb directly. Ya Allah, show me. No? Kaisa karte hain? Allah ta'ala kahe ko bharosa nahi hai. Iman nahi hai. Nahi hai. Dil ke itmanan ke waste. You don't believe? He said, no, I believe. But for the reinforcement of that belief.
Qala walam tu'min. Qala bala.
Of course, why not?
Walakin liyatma'inna qalbi.
See the closeness. He didn't even run away. He didn't say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't you have, no, I have iman. Okay, no problem. No. Laad hai bhai. Mohabbat hai Allah. He's talking to the one he loves. Ya Allah, show me how do you make things alive. Allah says, why, you don't believe? No, I believe. Please. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the response. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
Qala, Allah said, this is what we said to him. فَقُذْ أَرْبَعَةً مِنَ الطَّيْرِ فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ ثُمَّ اجْعَلْ عَلَى كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِّنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا ثُمَّ ادْعُوهُنَّ يَاتِينَكَ سَعْيًا وَعَلَمَنْ لَلَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, okay, so I will show you. Now how do you show? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go and get four birds. Right? Find four birds, tame those birds, make them your friends so that they come to you when you call them. And then, when these birds are tamed and they come to you when you call them, then slaughter those birds, chop them up, make them into pieces. Allah ki vishan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, alright, so there's your donkey, dead, come back alive. So I showed you. No! Allah wants to show his khudrat. So Allah says, go find food. Now imagine, think about this. I was thinking about this whole thing. Wild birds, you can't just catch a bird and tame it. It won't tame. So taming a bird means usually taking the chick out of the nest. And then hand raising that chick. Whatever time it takes. It won't take years, but it'll take a couple of months anyway. Until that chick knows you and you know it sits on your shoulder, whatnot, and all this. So it takes time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you want to know me? Do some work. You want to connect with me? Do some work. It won't just happen by some, you know, jadu, no. So Ibrahim alayhi salam now, wallahu alam, Allah didn't say all this, is my reflection on this. So he gets these birds, he tames them and so on, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? He says, now slaughter them. Chop them up, mix them up, then take one, now this is one mixture of all the four birds, all kinds of body parts, everything is together, right? The feathers and the works. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, take one piece of this, or one, you know, what do you call it, a clump of this, one portion of it, and go and put it on one hill. Then take another portion and go far away on another hill. Now imagine all this work, climb on the hill, up and down. So then take another portion, go another hill. 4, 5, 6, whatever number of hills. And then he says, call them, they will all come back to you. Huh? Put yourself in Ibrahim alayhi salam's position. What he must have felt, wallah. Hey. This is why the mashayikhin, when they used to give tarbiyah to people, they would do this. They would take one ayah. Sometimes they would take one word. And they would say, go and think about this. Reflect. What is it doing to you inside? What's going on inside your mind? What's in your heart? How are you connecting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the meaning of learning the Quran. This is the meaning of learning, the tarbiyah of learning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The whole issue of Islah. We have reduced everything to one routine, one, you know, automated, like robots. Even read the Quran like a robotic thing. Imagine Ibrahim alayhi salam's situation. What he must have felt. So what is our learning from this? How do you talk to Allah? Build a connection with Allah. Become obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Stop defying Allah. Stop arguing. Stop doing stupid things. You know it is wrong. You know the thing is prohibited in Islam. You know the thing is against the sunnah. You still do it. And then you say, my dua is not accepted. How will it be accepted? Please tell me. How will it be accepted? So become obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Get your life on the sunnah as much as possible. Do not go deliberately. Do not break any sunnah on Rasulullah sallam. And then spend time with Allah. How do you build a relationship with anybody? By spending time with them. The more you are with them, the more you get to know them, the more you love them, the more you get close to them, the less formality you have. So get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Spend time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you make dua, think of ways to praise Allah. How will I praise Allah? I told you this, the hadith of the Surah Al-Fatiha, which the other day I mentioned in one of the lectures, but maybe some of you were not here. In Tafsir Ibn Kathir rahmatullahi alayhi mentions this hadith narrated by Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu in Surah Al-Fatiha in Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, where he said Rasulullah informed us that a man in the past, he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the following words. And the man said, Rabbi lakal hamdu kama yambaghi li jalali wajhika wa azimi sultanik. He said, oh my Rabb, lakal hamd, all praise and all thanks is to you. How much? Kama yambaghi li jalali wajhik. Equal to the grace and glory and magnificence of your face. Wa azimi sultanik. Equal to the greatness and glory and magnificence of your kingdom. Rabbi lakal hamdu kama yambaghi li jalali wajhik wa azimi sultanik. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the angels, the recording angels, the kiram and katibin, they had never heard these words before. So they did not know what reward to write for these words. So they go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, as I mentioned before, anytime you hear a hadith like this, please understand. When you hear, for example, I'm going to say to you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked them, what did my slave say? But understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what the slave said, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew what the slave was going to say before he even said it. So why does Allah ask this question? Allah asked this question to establish the hujjah, to establish the proof in favor of his slave on the day of judgment, where these angels will come and bear witness that, Ya Allah, your slave praised you like this. So this is the rahmat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he asks a question like this. So the malaika go and say, Ya Rabbal Alameen, your slave praised you in words that we have never heard before. So what reward should we write? How much reward should we write? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the angels, what did he say? And the angels would repeat the words. Ya Allah, your slave said, Rabbi lakal hamdu kama yambaghi li jalali wajhika wa azimi sultanik. So what reward must we write? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to the angels, write the words of my slave as he said them. And I will reward him in keeping with the glory and magnificence of my face. And I will reward him in keeping with the glory and magnificence of my kingdom. So what is that reward? Who is going to quantify that reward? Who is going to quantify the reward? So when you are sitting and making dua, when you want to talk to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, think of how should I address Allah. Ask Allah to put the words in your heart and say, Allah, tell me what must I say to you? How must I say it? For all of this, you are required, what is required is for you to sit quietly in one place. No phones, no things going beep beep and whatnot, and nobody disturbing you. And this whole technology world is useful, obviously, but it's taken away the whole benefit of solace, of solitude, of khilwa. There's always noise in the system, which is very bad. It's very, very bad for the soul. So get rid of that. Leave your phones and so on aside. Sit quietly in one place and talk to Allah. Talk to Allah. Ask Allah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was walking and he passed by Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu reports this. Sayyidina Anas bin Malik radhiyallahu anhu reports this thing. He said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed by a Bedouin who was making dua. So Rabbi sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped there to listen to what he was saying. It's a very beautiful dua. In Arabic, I'm reading for you the translation. The man says, "Oh, the one whom eyes cannot see." He's talking to Allah. He says, "Oh, the one whom eyes cannot see, who cannot be imagined, who is beyond description, who is unaffected by happenings, by the ups and downs of life, who cannot be overwhelmed by the twists and turns of time, who knows the weight of the mountains, the volume of the oceans, the number of falling raindrops, the number of leaves on trees, and everything upon which the night darkens and upon which the day brightens." Ajib. In Arabic, it sounds even nicer. But he's saying this. He's talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he says, "No sky can hide another from him. No surface of the earth can hide another from him. No ocean can hide anything within its depths from him. And no mountain can conceal from him anything within its rocks." And then he says, "Make the last part of my life the best. And make the best of my deeds the last of my deeds. And make my best day, may that be the day I meet you." Three things. Oh Allah, make the last part of my life the best of my life. And make the last of my deeds the best of my deeds. And make the day that I meet you the best day of my life. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked one of the sahaba to stay there. And he said, when he finishes his salah and his dua and everything else, bring him to me. So when they brought the man to him, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a lump of gold which was given to him from some mine. So he gave that gold, that piece of gold to this man. And he asked him, he said, "Do you know why I'm giving you this?" The man said that you gave me this gold because I am related to you, because I am from the tribe of Banu Amir bin Sa'sa, and they are related to the Quraysh, and so I am related to you, and that's why you gave me this, to maintain ties of family. Rasulullah said, "Family ties have a right." But he said, "I gave you this gold because of the beautiful way in which you described Allah." He said, "I gave you this gold because of the beautiful way in which you praised Allah." My brothers and sisters, I want to say to you, praise Allah. Sit quietly and ask Allah, "Allah, how should I praise you? What must I say?" And Allah will put the words in your heart. Praise Allah. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah did not put any limit and any condition to what to ask. Abu Hurairah radhiyallahu anhu tells us about the best time to do that. And you know this. He said, in the last third of the night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the first heaven. And this is in Bukhari and Muslim. So the Rabb descends every night. We're talking about Laylatul Qadr. And alhamdulillah, we ask Allah to give us Laylatul Qadr. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the first heaven not only on Laylatul Qadr, on every single night of the year. You're making a lot of effort to get Laylatul Qadr by coming and making i'tikaf and so on and so forth. But this is available to you for free. Every night. Every single night that we are alive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the first heaven in a way that suits His majesty and grace. And then says, "Who will call upon me that I may answer him?" You want to talk to Allah? Talk to Allah. Allah is there waiting, listening. "Who will call me that I might answer him?" Who is there to stand up and say, "Labbaik, Allahumma labbaik. Oh Allah, I am here. Oh Allah, I am here." Or are we among those who are sleeping? Allah is asking, "Who is there to call on me?" It's not me, Allah. I got no problem. I am fast asleep. That's why Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, If you want Allah to listen to you when you have difficulties, talk to Allah when you don't have difficulties. Make dua when you are free from difficulties. Thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah will listen to you when you have troubles. So Allah says, who will call upon me that I may answer him? Who will ask me that I may give him? Who is here with who does not have want? Which one of you does not need something? And which one of you needs something that even Allah cannot give? Is there something like that? And that's why one of my shuyukh, he says, if you really want something and you're not praying tahajjud, then you really don't want that thing. If you really want something but you're not praying tahajjud, it means you really don't want that thing. Because if you really want that thing, how come you're not praying tahajjud? Allah is saying, who will ask me so I can give him? And Allah says, who will seek my forgiveness that I may forgive him? Which one of us does not need the forgiveness of Allah? Who will call upon me that I may answer him? Who will ask me that I may give him? And who will seek my forgiveness that I may forgive him? And this is in Bukhari. Talk to Allah. No formality. Very easy. There's a beautiful nazam in Urdu. And I must apologize to my Arab brothers. Translating poetry into any other language destroys it. So bear with me. So I'm just going to do it in Urdu. Most of you understand Urdu anyway. And his nazam is, Ek charwaha kisi jangal mein tha, Ek charwaha kisi jangal mein tha, Ya mahe kamil kisi badal mein tha. Mahe kamil is the full moon. It's hidden behind a cloud. Ya mahe kamil kisi badal mein tha, Ya de maula mein hamesha mast tha, Aasma uski zami par past tha, Yaad karte karte thak jata tha jab, Cheekh utta dard se ba sartab, Tu meri kutiya mein kyun aata nahi. Kutiya is hut. He's talking to Allah. Tu meri kutiya mein kyun aata nahi, Kya mera jangal tujhe bhata nahi, Aao tara arsh se ghar mein mere, पांव धो धो कर पीऊंगा मैं ते रात दिन झूला झुलाऊंगा तेरा सुबह उठकर मुंह धुलाऊंगा तेरा भीख दर दर मांग कर मैं लाऊंगा पहले तुझे खिलाकर मैं खाऊंगा किसको बोल रहे अर रज्जाकुल कुव्वत अल मतीन भीख दर दर मांग कर मैं लाऊंगा पहले तुझे खिलाकर मैं खाऊंगा कर रहा था वो यूं ही शोरो फुगा हजरत मूसा भी आ निकले वहां डांट कर बोले अरे बकता है क्या डांट कर बोले अरे बकता है क्या नूर मुतलक को मुकय्यद कर दिया किस कदर कमबख्त तू नादान है क्या खुदा तेरी तरह इंसान है कर चुके मूसा जब उसको दिल हजी हजरते हक से वही आई वही क्या किया मूसा ये तूने क्या किया कर दिया बंदे को मौला से जुदा क्या किया मूसा ये तूने क्या किया कर दिया बंदे को मौला से जुदा तुझको भेजा जोड़ने के वास्ते तू नहीं था तोड़ने के वास्ते तुझको भेजा जोड़ने के वास्ते तू नहीं था तोड़ने के वास्ते होशियारों का तरीका और है दिल जलों के और ये कुछ और है दिल जलों के और दिल जला कौन है जो के अपने महबूब से दूर है जुदाई का उसे फिराक है जुदाई का गम है मिलने की ख्वाहिश है बेतहाशा मिलना चाहता है क्या अल्लाह बदल से मिलना चाहता है नबी सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम से दवन हु वांट्स टू मीट हिज रब वांट्स टू मीट हिम जो अल्लाह से मिलना चाहता है अल्लाह उससे मिलना चाहते हैं میں تو بولتا ہے اللہ میں آپ سے ملنا چاہتا ہوں. بلڈ اے کنیکشن وتھ اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ, ٹاک ٹو اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ, اللہ سے باتیں کرو, اللہ سے لاڑ کرو, اللہ سے ضد کرو, اللہ کے سامنے رو, اللہ کو مانگو, اللہ کو بلاؤ. اللہ نے کوئی بھی رکاوٹ نہیں رکھی. اللہ ہیز ناٹ کیپٹ اینی باؤنڈریز, نو فارمیلٹیز, نتھنگ از ریکوائرڈ ڈاکٹر رسوار, ناٹ وضو, ناٹ غسل, ناٹ اسٹینڈنگ, ناٹ سٹنگ, ناٹ اینی ویئر, اینی ہاؤ ٹاک ٹو اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu to connect you with Him. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open your hearts to His Noor. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Jalla Jalaluhu to illuminate your lives, your hearts, your spirits, your homes, your businesses, your families with His Noor Jalla Jalaluhu. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you those words which please Him. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the words to praise Him that have never been used by any creature on the face of the earth. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give each one of you such words which have never been used before, which please Him. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward you for that in keeping with His majesty and grace. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to completely astound you and delight you with His rewards. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call you to His arsh on the day of judgment. And ask you to praise Him the way you used to praise Him in this dunya. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill your heart for the love of His kalam, Al-Quran Al-Kareem. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill your hearts with the love of His Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put the desire to follow the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your heart and to make your lives completely and totally on the sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant that you stand in the night in tahajjud, that you read Surah Al-Fatiha, and then you ask Allah, Ya Allah, what do you want to hear? Which surah do you want to hear? And I know you are not a Hafiz Quran, so it's not, you are going to decide. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, I want to hear Surah Al-Furqan. But I don't know Surah Al-Furqan. And Allah says, you don't need to know Surah Al-Furqan, because I know Surah Al-Furqan. And I will make you recite. I will give you the words, just repeat. Ask Allah to give you this experience, inshallah. Stand in sahajud, read Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the rukun of salah. Then say, Ya Allah, what do you want to hear? Give me your kalam so I can recite it back to you. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that every single day of your life from today onwards, a day must not pass that you have not prayed tahajud, inshallah. And then I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the same dua that the Bedouin asked for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him gold. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the last days of your life the best days of your life, the most honored days of your life, the most comfortable days of your life, the happiest days of your life. And then I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take you in a state when He is pleased with you and to make that last amal of yours the best amal of your life. And an amal which is accepted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the day when you meet Him the absolutely the best day of your life, because there can be no day which is better than the day that we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil kareem wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursaleen wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.